Next up, we have Shannon Maher, Engineering Director at Google, whose presentation is entitled Innovation at Corporate Scale. Here we're going to learn how a company can itself be designed to actively foster innovation. Shannon will share what has worked well and what hasn't. I note from his bio that while Shannon has a very strong technical background, electrical engineering and computer science at MIT, and a master's in geophysics at Colorado University, and is employed, has evolved a career in engineering via AOL and Google, his primary drive is innovation. Shannon once had the honor to be able to watch a beautiful sunrise with five of the six tallest peaks, tallest mountains in the world visible, from Gokyo Peak at 17,500 feet in Nepal, accompanied only by a female who went on to become Shannon's wife. So let's give a big hand to Shannon Maher. Thank you, Shannon.
So that was actually the first time I've ever seen my brother speak. It's always messy around him, and I apologize for that. I have a modest little topic to talk about, and I have 15 minutes to talk about it, innovation. I'd be glad to talk with any of you for several hours over beers of an innovation. So instead of, where's the clicker? So I'm going to modify that. I think as an industry, we do a very good job at innovation with small companies, and you'll see the examples of that out on the floor. See the examples of that in many of our high-tech centers. What's a little bit more problematic is being able to maintain that level of innovation at a really large scale, to be able to take our large-scale companies with the resources they have, with the reach they have, and the monetary potential, and continue to innovate over time. So a corporate scale is a much harder problem in my mind. If you want to innovate within a company, in one project, you create a skunk works, you recruit the best people, you get the passionate people, and you can go create new rules for that group, you can go and become innovative. How do you make the whole company be innovative over the long term? That's kind of what, just a note on my background. I am no longer with Google, so I will talk a lot about Google, but I'm no longer a member of the company, so I'm not a corporate shill, but I am still very, very tied to the company. I think it is a great company. So if you look at some of the companies that we've feeded as being incredibly innovative over time, I just grabbed a bunch here. I want to represent a bunch of different things. Companies and organizations. NASA kind of doesn't have a mission anymore, so to speak. Bell Labs is gone. Polaroid and digital. As a kid, those are the ones I wanted to go to. They don't exist anymore. Canon, innovative at a very high level, is the most innovative from the number of patents filed. That's not the metric I want to use. Certainly Facebook and Sony, and there's others. This is not meant I don't want to cause a discussion on what's the most innovative companies of all time. Again, the only one I've seen of that on the internet, I use the Google. The only discussion of that type I've seen on the internet claimed that Canon was because it had filed the most IP. A reasonable metric, not the one I want to use. If you look at the three on the bottom, there's a Fast Company magazine has done a survey naming the top 50 for the last 5 years. They've only done that survey, that list for the last 5 years. And these are the only three companies to make it for the last 5 years. I would say that if you had gone back a few more years, Amazon wouldn't be on there. They didn't exist. Google didn't exist. And Apple went through their period before Steve Jobs came back. So the real quandary, the real question is, how do you maintain a focus and maintain an ability to continually innovate all the way across your company? So I looked at those. There's lots and lots of papers on innovation. I've seen very few papers on corporate innovation. But I looked at those companies that I picked out and some others like them, and I pulled out some common features. Typically, the companies that are innovative at scale have garnered for themselves a very large breadth of products, and and are trying to solve the hardest products, the hardest problems in the world today. Their missions are very broad and very large. They tend to have well-defined corporate cultures. Some of them very different, but well-defined corporate cultures. Tend to be people-centric. I'll go through some of the people issues here in a second, but you can't innovate without the best and the brightest of people. And they almost always have strong leadership or a very strong vision. The one or two times that wasn't the case, I would say in the ones I presented, would be NASA and Bell Labs. NASA had leadership from Congress back when the US Congress could lead, but that's a whole different story. Okay. So my thesis, and what I'd like to say to you, after 7.5 years at Google, seven years at AOL, 5 years at the company Halliburton, which is the one that blew up the Deepwater Horizon, my thesis is that for a company to be successful, you have to be able to optimize all aspects of the corporation in light of innovation. How do we make everything this corporation does, all the facets of it, HR, payroll, hiring, engineering, product, sales, how do we look at all the processes, everything we do, and make sure that that's optimized for innovation? So my categorization of people, the management structure, and I'll go through these more and really tell you about how Google's done that. Processes, priorities, and policies, and their products and projects. Okay, so this is my disqualifier. This is just so you know, the reason you have a tag team of brothers is Barry was contracted to do this, and he talked to the organizer and said, I have this brother who just left Google, who spent 7 years at Google in a leadership position. By the way, I spent most of my time over in Europe, in London and in Zurich. In a leadership position at Google, 5 years at AOL, 7 years at AOL in a leadership position, and 5 years at Halliburton. He'd like to talk about innovation. And they said, yeah, okay, bring him along. This is not an unbiased, from now on, I'm going to tell you how I've seen Google attack those problems. This is not meant to be an unbiased discussion. This is meant to open the veil a little bit of how this obviously very innovative company works. I do say Google, AOL, and Halliburton. I consider them the good, the bad, and the ugly. I won't tell you which one I think is which, but you can probably figure that out. Yeah, okay. That was just, I'm not as funny as Barry is. Okay, but innovation does start with people. I mean, we know this. People have the thoughts, people have the understanding of the market, people are the ones that drive the products. Google is incredibly and anally focused on bringing, attracting and identifying and retaining and motivating talented people, and the best and the brightest. As are this is not unique, as are the other companies, as is everybody, I think, but as are the other companies who have been up on that list. So, in fact, there's many optimizations within the HR process and the hiring process that I'll go through around these issues. And it spent an awful lot of money, an awful lot of resources, an awful lot of management attention on this. And, in fact, it's been named for the last 4 years in a row the best company to work for in the United States. Has been named to have the number one intern program and has been named on LinkedIn to be the most desired employer. These are testaments to the fact that it not only is focused on that, to some extent it's got it right. I have been with other companies and with small companies that I've been one of the principal leaders of that said that they have the same focus on people, and that's the end of what happened. We care about people. Go do your job. Innovate. Thank you. Tell me when you're done innovating. That's very insufficient. It's business as usual after making the statement. Okay, so how do you do this? Well, I think Google has a well-known set of perks and a very well-defined culture. The corporate culture at Google is real. So from the outside, anybody here work at Google, by the way? Or anybody have ever interviewed at Google? Okay. The corporate culture, from the outside, it looks very mysterious, like Google has this plan for everything. But on the inside, it's a very open, sharing environment. To the extent that the name Googlers, people at Google have given to themselves as Googlers, Googlers see everything that the board sees except for the final financials when Eric O'Leary or Sergey does a presentation of the board. Extraordinary openness, extraordinary sharing of information. It's a very collaborative company. The idea is that you're going to get the best and the brightest. You want to pull their thoughts and information out of them. You've got 35,000 employees. How do you do that? The only way to do that, you give as much information down, and you expect something to come back up. It does have, this is in some senses a somewhat difficult thing to pull off. It has a very consensus-driven decision-making process for projects at the bottom, driven from the top by strategy. So strategy tends to come from the VPs, SVPs, and the executives, but everything below that is done by consensus. What you're going to build, how you're going to build it, what market you're attacking, all that. The perks of Google, anybody never heard of the perks of Google? Okay. So some of them might seem fairly outrageous. Some of them, the important ones, the most expensive ones, include free meals, three meals a day. In most offices, any office with over 100 people. We used to have free ski trips. We took all of Google Europe and went to Courmayeur every year. Massages, I don't know if you can see the background there, it says Google Massage here. Massages, it's a nice thing. So there's multiple reasons for having these perks, though. It's not only to attract and retain people, but the food is a core element in the communications. With a large company, the difference between a small company and a large company, small companies I claim can innovate easily, large companies can't, is that you don't have time to talk to the people in the rest of the company in a small company. If you require, give people food and make them use that time sitting next to other people, almost nobody sits and eats at their desk, then you have the time to have spontaneous conversations about what are you doing? Have you tried this? Do you know what's happening over there? You meet people, you have colleagues that you share interests with, you can track things over time. So the perks are intended for info sharing, for creating relationships and creating a sense of common purpose. There are other sets of perks that Google has created just for convenience. Especially in California, the Mountain View campus, you can get everything from a haircut, if you need a haircut, or to get your laundry done, dry cleaning, get your oil changed in your car. None of these cost Google a cent, by the way. So these are types of things you could do if you have enough scale at almost any company, because the employee still pays for it himself, but it does mean that you don't have the breaks in your time. And if anybody here is in engineering, in almost any task, but certainly in software engineering, any break in your time from doing what you're doing to do something else to come back is hugely expensive in terms of productivity, in terms of innovation, in terms of getting things done. So they've really gone out of their way to get rid of the breaks in time. So these are some of the things that have caused Google to be named number one employer. The interviewing at Google is again well described and is well highly panned in the outside world. That is, nobody understands why they do it. Now, I can't defend all the processes of Google. For quite a while, I went through 20 interviews, my first time through interviewing with Google. At this point, we're typically interviewing people five times. So I apologize if you've been stuck in the interminable interview process. But let me tell you why this is happening. Some of the people on the board at Google have been through many different startups, at least at the start, and there's this insight that A people tend to hire B people. A-level people tend to hire B-level people. I don't want somebody who's going to compete with me. I want somebody who I can control. B-level people tend to hire C-level people. And you get this regression to the mean of people. So Google didn't want that, and Google created this highly, highly defined, partially objective process. The idea was to try to get as much information about candidates up front, have as many people talk to them as possible, have a standard forms filled out. Anybody who does an interview on the inside at Google has to fill out a long review of the interview. It takes longer to fill out the review than it does to do the interview. That goes to an independent committee that looks over all the feedback and stack ranks candidates and says, people above this level, we'll try to hire. People below this level, we're not going to make an offer to right now. That happens all over the world, and those get then sent, the results of that then get sent to another committee who makes sure that everybody's hiring at the same level. There is no such thing as a hiring manager at Google. I was a senior director at Google. I never hired one person. I built teams from zero to 150 twice. I never hired one person. I got people through this process. I participated in the process. I was one of the people on one of those committees. So this removes the A-level to B-level, B-level to C-level problem. It also removes somebody hiring their friends. It also removes too much direct influence over who's hired, so you get different types of cultures and different groups. It is also very expensive and relatively slow. But on the other hand, Google's grown to 35,000 people in about 15 years, mostly organically, so you can make it work. It also allowed Google to hire pretty uniformly across the world. So the hiring techniques in China are fundamentally the same as they are in Mountain View, are fundamentally the same as they are in Zurich, are fundamentally the same as London. Okay. Let's see. Okay, does anybody heard of this movie, The Internship? No? Okay. Anyways, so there have been very few of these kinds of movies. There have been two movies that I know of that have been made of, three movies about high-tech firms, one about Facebook, one about the social network, one about AOL, you got Mail, and now The Internship about Google. I have not seen it. I don't care to see it. It looks kind of stupid. But interns are very important to Google in terms of garnering the great people. We have a very deep I no longer work at Google. Google has a very deep internship program. Gives interns real projects with real responsibility. These are some of the smartest people in the computer science departments of some of the best universities in the world. It has a shorter but very similar interview process and selection process because we don't have as much time to do it. It was named the number one internship by Glassdoor. And lots of people, about 40% of the people in Google in any 1 year might come in through the internship program. So what is Google optimized about management? Oh, by the way, let me just say a couple things about other companies and small startups I've worked with before. Every other company I've worked with has had a much more vanilla hiring process, a much more vanilla evaluation process, and nowhere near the focus on internships. And I think that's an important differentiator. Google is very engineering driven, and I think this is important for innovation. And what I mean by that is not that sales will say this is what we need and this is what we can sell, and it's not that marketing will say here is where the market's going to. It's a combination of some marketing people and the best of the engineers, the engineering leadership, saying here's how we can leapfrog everything. There's a very serious effort to not do incremental release, to not just do incremental fixes and move forward incrementally, to do quantum leaps in technology. Exceptionally flat. There was a VP at Google, no longer quite so flat, but there was a VP at Google who had 150 direct reports. 150 direct reports, that's flat. Now, that means that you have a management structure where the personnel management happens by peer processes. But it also means that you have very little in the way from the bottom to the top. And I don't think there was ever more than four or five levels between my lowest engineer and Eric or Larry at any time. And I've had groups of 150 to 250 people. Bottoms-up decision-making, you involve the people in your decisions. The people that you spend all this money, you get all these talented people, you have to have them involved in your decision. It's some of what Barry was talking about, but it's also ensuring that these people know that their decisions, what they're going to make, what they're going to be responsible for. This is a techie issue, but I think it's actually very, very key if there's IT people in here. Many projects, you see a combination of three people making decisions: the technical lead, the product lead, and a program manager. Google doesn't use program managers. They have the two key leads, the person who's leading from the market perspective, the person who's leading from the engineering perspective. They get together. Two people is far, far easier to get consensus on and to move quickly than three. One very, very big move, many companies have great research groups. Microsoft has great research groups. I've seen almost nothing hit the market, except for maybe the paperclip and Bob, and I don't know if anybody remembers Microsoft Bob. But very little comes into the market out of that. On the other hand, Google embeds the research group. They're in a research group. They're reporting up into a research director and vice president. They are embedded right in the product groups. So the people who, on your Android phone, did the work for voice recognition, they were embedded with my group doing the mobile app for that. They worked side by side. The research group actually writes and delivers code. It's incredibly, incredibly important and incredibly innovative. You get some of the best thinkers sitting back next to very good engineers. Some of these people are not the best coders, but very good engineers. And all engineers are at the same level. There's no continuing engineering. You write a product, you are supporting it too. I'm going to move quickly. Let's see. So like every other company, any innovative company, what's the biggest thing they want? It's speed. Get your product out to the market. Have the market tell you what's happening. Iterate. Change it. Give the market what they want. So this up and down, this is the most important metric at Google. Time to first launch and then time to iterate. So that is focused on. It's what people are evaluated on. That plus their impact on the company. And it's just emphasized to the nth degree. One other thing, and that's really important both in engineering and sales, is that people are not only allowed to, but requested to move between projects and between locations. There's a lot of movement from the States to here, between the 11 engineering centers in Europe. There's a lot of movement, and this is a good thing. This is what fosters the communication and lets people know what's really going on. I won't go over this. I want to go with that one. So one of the last things I'll mention on this is one of the things that everybody talks about. This is what makes Google innovative, 20% time. Well, you know, not so much. 20% time is when every engineer gets a fifth of their time, allegedly gets a fifth of their time to do whatever they want to do, but they actually have to be working then. That has produced some good things. What it does for a director is allowed me to does somebody have a good idea? I can say, go find 5 engineers, 10 engineers, to all contribute their 20% time, and we can actually prototype that real quickly. So it does allow a degree of freedom that you don't have without that, but it's not as though that there are a ton of new things that came directly out of 20% time without some utilization and some forcing functions by other people. It's a good thing. It's a very good thing. But it is not the end all and be all of innovation. Google also for quite a long time had this thing called the 70-20-10, where 70% of their resources would be devoted toward the core product, which was search and ads forever. 20% would be devoted toward spin-offs of the core product, which would be display ads, for instance, not search ads, and 10% of something radical and new. And I'll talk about some of those. You've heard about the radical and new things, and I'll go over that. Okay, so the last thing I wanted to talk about here was the scope of ambition. And I do say that having been an engineer, looking for places, the ambitious projects are the ones where engineers naturally gravitate to. Google clearly has a scope of ambition. I'm not going to go through all these, but if you just look at the Google homepage and you look at all the products that are off the homepage and down the More button, then there's at the bottom of this, there's a huge number of products there. These products all delivered at scale, all delivered to anybody who wants, and all of these are free. And under the Even More button there, there's some pretty big stuff like Chrome, which is the number one browser in the world. So that's hidden away down under Even More. And Scholar, Blog Search, There's also the business-to-business products, so all the ads. Don't come into that. So we have two different types of ads, plus, okay, and Google Fiber. Google X is this just recently announced initiative that's doing all new, brand new things, which includes Google Glass, which we tried to get for you guys today, but couldn't get a copy of it. Chauffeur, which is the self-driven car. And Loon, which was just announced, which is a series of balloons to relay the internet up at the upper atmosphere to act for access in places inaccessible. One more class of projects, then I'll wrap it up. Is that one of the things? This is Google's data center in the Dalles, Oregon. Google designs all their own infrastructure, including all the networking. All the computers are designed by Google. And all the stack that's built on top of that is built on open source, but is designed by Google, including all the mechanisms for ganging multiple computers together, making them into supercomputers at scale, and all the stack above that. So there's a huge number of projects there. There are some challenges, cost. This is a quote from Eric, that he was in London and he looked out and said, great new cafeteria, cost $1 million to redo it. Some people see a great retention tool, and he sees a high gross margin product. You got to have the money to pay for this sort of stuff. If you want to work at scale, you got to pay money. This is not cheap. Performance management is a particularly tricky subject when you're doing very innovative things, because you're introducing much higher risk. And when somebody fails on a much higher risk project, you don't want to push them to not be risking in the future. And getting closure and collaborative decision making. Okay, so I guess we probably don't have time for Q&A, but
what would be the one question, or what would be the one piece of advice, or the one action that companies could take to incorporate innovation into their organization?
So I think the small scale companies have that, because the leaders are the people who are passionate and know the product, and you're typically focusing on one product. When you get to multiple products, what's the most important thing is executive sponsorship of all these costs, understanding and sponsorship of all these costs. You cannot continue to be innovative unless you compete for the best people, unless you give your talent what they can get elsewhere, and unless you really understand the cost and the return of innovation.
Great. Well, thank you, Shannon. Thank you.